Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Hammer Museum. I'm Claudia Bester. I'm the Director of Public Programs here at the Hammer, and I'm pleased to welcome you to the Billy Wilder Theater. Throughout 2015, the Hammer Museum and the UCLA Institute of the Environment and Sustainability are exploring the most pressing issues surrounding the current and future state of water around the globe in our year-long series called The Next Wave: Quality, Quantity, and Accessibility of Water in the 21st Century. Every month, we're doing a program focusing on one critical water issue, including ocean plastics, drought in California, fracking, international water supplies, and water rights. And you can see our past 7 programs as video podcasts on the Hammer website. Mark Gold is our moderator tonight, and he'll start the program by presenting a broad overview of the issue. And then our guest speaker will give a presentation here at the podium, and then he'll sit down for a discussion with Mark Gold. And then at the end, we'll take audience questions. You should have all received 3x5 cards for writing down your questions. When we get closer to the Q&A, we'll send around ushers to collect your cards and bring them up to the stage. If you didn't get a note card or you need some extras, you can just raise your hand and an usher will bring you another card. Please be sure to write your questions very, very clearly so that Mark Gold can read them to our guest speaker. Tonight we're talking about ocean acidification, which is a global problem with local impacts. Over the past 2 centuries, atmospheric carbon dioxide concentrations have dramatically increased, leading to rising sea levels, global warming, and ocean acidification. Tonight, Dr. Richard Feely will address the consequences of an acidifying ocean. Dr. Feely is a NOAA Senior Fellow at the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration's Pacific Marine Environmental Laboratory in Seattle. He's also a professor at the University of Washington School of Oceanography. His major research areas are carbon cycling in the oceans and ocean acidification processes. He received a BA in chemistry from University of St. Thomas in St. Paul, and a Master of Science and a PhD from Texas A&M in chemical oceanography. He's the co-chair of the U.S. Climate Variability and Predictability Program's Carbon Dioxide Repeat Hydrography Program. He was a past member of the steering committee for the U.S. Carbon and Biochemistry Program, and he's presently a member of the U.S. Interagency Working Group on Ocean Acidification. He's also a member of the International Imbersolus Ocean Acidification Group. He's a member of the American Geophysical Union, the American Association for the Advancements of Science, and the American Chemical Society. Dr. Feely has authored more than 250 scholarly peer-reviewed research publications. He was awarded the Department of Commerce Gold Award in 2006 for research on ocean acidification. In 2007, he was elected to be a fellow of the American Geophysical Union. In 2010, he was awarded the Heinz Environmental Award for his pioneering research on ocean acidification. In 2014, Dr. Feely received the NOAA Administrator's Award for his work as a lead author in Chapter 3 of the 2013 Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change Report. And in case you're not aware, the 2007 Nobel Peace Prize was awarded jointly to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and U.S. Vice President Al Gore Jr. for their efforts to build up and disseminate greater knowledge about man-made climate change and to lay the foundations for the measures that are needed to counteract such change. And Dr. Feely was an important contributor to that Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report. So we're really honored to have someone of his stature here with us tonight who's made such a significant contribution to scientifically documenting the devastating effects of increased carbon dioxide gases in the Earth's atmosphere. So now I'd like to bring out my colleague, Mark Gold, who will give us an overview and then serve as moderator for tonight's program. Mark is the UCLA Associate Vice Chancellor of Environment and Sustainability, the Chair of the UCLA Sustainability Committee, and the Director of the UCLA Coastal Center at the UCLA Institute of the Environment and Sustainability. In other words, he's the UCLA Sustainability Czar. He formerly served as president of the environmental group here at Heal the Bay and has worked extensively over the last 20 years in the field of coastal protection and water pollution. Please join me in welcoming Mark Gold.
Well, first of all, thank you to everyone who decided that the world's oceans are a lot more important than my brother talking about Kogi trucks at Royce Hall at the same exact time. So thank you for being here tonight. Nobody got up and left. Okay, so that's a good sign too. All right, so over the years, I've seen numerous environmental problems off our coasts and in the world's oceans. Dead zones at the mouths of polluted rivers and sewage treatment plant outfalls, plastic pollution, making our beaches look like landfills after rain and entangling a variety of marine life. Harmful algal blooms and hypoxia events causing massive fish kills. People getting sick from swimming or surfing in sewage and runoff polluted waters. The destruction of our wetlands, estuaries, and reefs and beaches due to overdevelopment or poorly planned development. Fish so contaminated with DDT and PCBs that they're unsafe for consumption. And the results of overfishing, less diversity, smaller fish in areas that used to have thriving ecosystems, and consumption of top marine predators such as sharks, dolphins, and whales. But the one issue that makes me fear for the long-term health of our oceans is ocean acidification. We're very, very fortunate tonight to have our nation's leading expert on ocean acidification, NOAA's own Dr. Richard Feeley, to talk to us about the current consequences of ocean acidification, the climate change link cause the impact, and the future of our oceans if we don't dramatically reduce our carbon emissions. Of course, so it's not completely depressing, we will talk about things that we can do as individuals to give our oceans a chance. But as you'll see, it's a much larger problem than most people know about. And with that, please welcome Dr. Richard Feeley.
Am I on? Can you hear me? Good. Great. Well, it's a great pleasure to be here at the Hammer Museum, and I want to thank Mark and Claudia for inviting me to come and speak to something that's near and dear to my heart. I've actually been working on this problem for 30 years. So you might say, well, how come it took you so long to get it public? And scientists are very careful people. They don't go public with issues unless they have enough knowledge they think it warrants public awareness, and this is certainly one of that. So we all know about climate change. We all understand that release of fossil CO2 into the atmosphere from the burning of coal, oil, and natural gas has caused a significant change in our Earth's temperature. And we know quite well that this is due to things like carbon dioxide that has increased in the atmosphere from a pre-industrial value of about 278 to its present value over 400 parts per million. The twin sister of climate change is ocean acidification. It's that same carbon dioxide that we have been releasing in the atmosphere that causes a change in the overall pH of the oceans. So this evening I'm going to explain to you what is ocean acidification, how it works. You all studied this in high school, so I'm going to just remind you of what you already know. How and why our coastal regions are more vulnerable to ocean acidification than the open ocean, particularly along the Washington, Oregon, California coast, and give you some glimpse of what the future may hold for us, what things will look like in the future. So that's our menu for tonight. And one of the things I want to point out is look at the past and see what great scientists have said about this 50, 60 years ago. And I wanted to point you to this paper. It's really one of the most well-known papers in climate literature. Roger Revelle, who was the director of Scripps Institute of Oceanography, and Hans Suess published this paper in 1957. And what they were talking about in this was about the great experiment, carrying out the large-scale geophysical experiment of a kind that could never happen again by releasing the carbon dioxide that comes from the organic matter buried in sediments. As we burn up all that carbon dioxide, we only can run this experiment once. And it was his view that this would, if we studied this very carefully with observations, we could understand how the oceans and atmosphere actually worked. And what he pointed out that the large increase in carbon dioxide production over the coming decades would cause a total increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere anywhere from 20 to 40%. Now, the amazing thing about this statement is he made that statement back in 1957 before there were any carbon dioxide measurements that were conducted in the atmosphere, and before there were any surveys of carbon dioxide in the oceans, large-scale surveys. So he had the vision. And in fact, this past year, we exceeded 400 parts per million in the atmosphere, and that is at 43%. So we already have exceeded his expectations for the planet. And one of the first things he did as director of Scripps is to hire Dr. David Charles Keeling, and he gave him the charge of developing the capability to measure CO2 in the atmosphere. And Charles Keeling was one of these great scientists that really concerned himself about making extraordinarily great measurements. And he set himself the task of measuring CO2 at the Mauna Loa site. And this is the longest record of CO2. This is the breathing of our planet in terms of CO2 concentrations. He started his work in 1957 and continued on until his death in 2007. And now the Ezra Laboratory in Boulder, Colorado continues his original work. It's this graph that's enshrined in the Smithsonian. It's the most important graph of biogeochemistry on our planet. And as a result of that CO2 that's been released in the atmosphere, we now know that the planet is warming. It's very clear. When you look at the top panel, it's the temperature. And then the bottom panel is the decadal changes in temperature. So you can see for the last 50 years, we have been increasing the global temperatures. And the IPCC process has been developed to assess the science as much as we possibly can. So every 7 years, we bring together 2,000 of the best climate scientists of the world and assess where we stand. And this is a summary of the first five assessment reports about how well we understand mankind's influence on the temperature in the atmosphere. And we started out in 1995 saying, oh, maybe there's a discernible human influence. And by the AR5 report in 2013, we have said that at least 95% confidence that the warming of our planet is due to humankind. So we have really gone a very long way in our understanding of the climate processes and their effects on our planet. Now, as I said, the twin sister of that is ocean acidification. So it's that same carbon dioxide that we burn, 2 trillion tons of carbon dioxide released into the atmosphere since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, that then gets taken up by the oceans. And that process is called ocean acidification. And that change in carbon dioxide decreases the pH. That's exactly why we call it ocean acidification. The term is relative to the process, the name of the process itself. In medical science, we have a similar name for that, and it's acidification processes. In medical science, same thing is true. It's the interesting thing about human beings is that the pH of our blood in human beings is about 7.45. That's actually basic. If we undergo a 0.32 or 0.3 pH change, it's still basic, but we would go into a disease called acidosis and you would be in a coma. That's how sensitive the human body is to acidification. Term is very similar, acidosis. So the reaction is very simple in seawater. Carbon dioxide exchanges across the air-sea interface. It reacts with water to form carbonic acid. Carbonic acid, anything you have, a soda, you will have carbonic acid in there that's added to it to give it its fizz. That acid then releases a hydrogen ion and causes the acidification. So you all know this from high school. So the IPCC process is to determine how much carbon dioxide has been released in the atmosphere and what are the rates that are occurring. And the latest documentation is from 2003 to 2012. And we're now releasing just about 10 petagrams of carbon in the atmosphere every year. That's 1 times 10 to the 15th grams of carbon dioxide that we're releasing in the atmosphere of the year, either through burning of forests and the release of carbon dioxide from the burning of forests, or the burning of fossil fuels. And that carbon dioxide is partitioned with 45% going into the atmosphere and being retained in the atmosphere, and that's what gives us our increase in the atmosphere. About 27% goes into reforestation in our temporal forests, and another 27% goes into the ocean. Now, our sister laboratory, as helped out by Dave Keeling, began developing measurements of carbon dioxide through the world, including the Mauna Loa record. And they now determine the concentration of carbon dioxide at 57 stations collecting samples every week. I want to point your attention to this output of what they do. So here's the South Pole, and here's the North Pole, and it starts in 1996. I'm going to just show you a short 15-year component of their record, and watch how the atmosphere changes. So you can see that in the northern hemisphere, we have the uptake of carbon dioxide in the terrestrial plants and in the oceans in the summertime with its release due to respiration. But the overall background of carbon dioxide is increasing throughout the entire planet. It increases a rate of about 2 parts per million per year during this decade. In the last decade, it was about 1.5. So we're actually increasing the rate of carbon dioxide release because the overall release of carbon dioxide is increasing at a rate of about 3% per year. And when we make measurements of the same carbon dioxide species in the oceans, and here's an example of data from Aloha Station off of Hawaii and two stations, Bermuda and Estac in the Atlantic Ocean. And the top plot is the, top plot is the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere compared to the CO2 concentration in the oceans. So the blues and greens are the time series stations in the oceans. You can see that there's a general agreement, much more variability in the ocean because a lot of biological processes occur in the ocean. And the pH changes are here. These are all measurements starting in the 1980s and going to the present time, and the carbonate ion concentration. So from measurements alone, we can see the acidification with a decrease in pH at the rate of about 0.0019 pH units per year. Now, this is a very, very dramatic rate, geologically speaking, and it's a very dramatic change, and we know this from measurements alone. So I'm just going to go through the chemistry again so you get all the chemistry. CO2 reacts with water to form carbonic acid. This is the weak acid that you have in pop. It dissociates to form a hydrogen ion. That's what gives it our acidity and lowers the pH. That hydrogen ion, and this is important, immediately reacts with a carbonate ion. Now, the carbonate ions are particularly important to animals that produce a calcium carbonate shell or skeleton, like the lobsters or the oysters or the clams or the coral reefs. They need that carbonate ion to produce their shells. If there's no carbonate ion, they can't produce their shells. So that's a problem for them. So this reaction of the hydrogen ion with the carbonate ion means that we are removing that carbonate ion species, making it more difficult for them to produce the shells or skeletons. And so what has happened is since the pre-industrial, average pH of seawater is 8.2. It is now 8.1. That means we've increased the hydrogen ion concentration by this reaction by 30%. Carbonate ion concentrations has also decreased by 16%. By the end of this century, in the IPCC business as usual scenarios that we know, we expect the pH to drop another 0.3 or 0.4 pH units, such that the hydrogen ion concentration will increase by 100 to 150%. And that carbonate ion concentration, which is so critical to formation of cells, will drop by 50%. This is mankind's influence on the surface of the ocean of a major chemical species in the ocean. Now, another point to consider, particularly for animals that live in the oceans, how fast can they adapt to this? Well, the rate of change that we're imposing on those ecosystems is phenomenal. In fact, if you look at the rates of change of temperature or carbon dioxide, mankind is changing things much more rapidly than we have done in the geological past. And our estimates are that the rate of change has increased for CO2 at a rate that's anywhere from 10 to 100 times faster than anything we've seen over the last 50 million years or so. And at least probably 10 times faster than anything we've seen over the last 300 million years. This is a major, major change to the chemistry of the oceans. And another component of this, and it's a critical component, I said that when you form calcium carbonate shells and skeletons, you take a calcium ion, which is incredibly abundant in the ocean, combine it with a carbon anion, form the calcium carbonate shell or skeletons. Geochemists have a measure of whether or not they can successfully do this, and that's called the saturation state. And when that saturation state is greater than one, they can produce their shells and skeletons. When that saturation state gets less than one, the shells begin to dissolve. And for some species of organisms, we can see that dissolution occur while the animal is still alive. And I'll show you an example of that in a moment. So it's my job, what I look at is where that changeover from supersaturation to undersaturation, where they can produce their shells and where they cannot. That's what I do for a living. And the common carbonate minerals the animals produce are usually aragonite, which is a more soluble form, dissolves more readily. Things like coral reefs, things like certain forms of oysters and clams, and pteropods, they first produce an aragonitic shell. And the less soluble phase is things like calcite, and these are things like, for example, foraminifera. So different animals have developed different strategies for combating this. And they do that by developing these less soluble forms when they can. So this is a model prediction of where we are now, where we might be in the future, given what decisions we make as human beings about CO2 emissions in the future. And the blue lines, this is in aragonite saturation values on the left-hand side and pH on the right-hand side. And what we're showing here is for the tropical oceans, the southern ocean, and the Arctic Ocean, so three different major regions. The blue line is for if we stop CO2 emissions right now, what would happen? You see the pH goes down, and then it quickly begins to recover. Not real quickly, you still see recovery taking place over a significant amount of time, but a recovery. The orange line here means if we allow CO2 in the atmosphere go up to about 550 parts per million, or the black line if we really just let everything go and we allow CO2 go up to about 900 parts per million. You can see in that case the pH goes down to 7.7 or so and then takes a very long time to recover. It takes over 10,000 years for it to recover. So the impacts that we are imposing on our planet right now has repercussions for thousands and thousands of years. That's the point of this slide. And it's something we should all be considering when we make our choices about CO2 emissions. So how we know this stuff? What do we do? What have we done and what do we do to know this? Well, it turns out that early in the 1990s, we started large-scale global ocean CO2 surveys. This is through the U.S. JGOS program and the WOS program and the Repeat Hydrography program, which I'm a member right now. And what we did is we took these very large ships. This is a NOAA ship, Ron Brown. We hang a rosette package with 32 bottles around there. This is in Antarctica right next to an iceberg. And we collect samples throughout the water column, 36 steps, and we bring them back. We actually analyze them for all the carbonate chemistry in real time. This is a 24-hour process. And by the time we get to the next stations, we're ready for the next suite of samples. Really, really well developed. We also have moorings. And the moorings have now pH monitors and CO2 monitors on the mooring. So we can do this for mooring and get really highly resolved time series. So we have some capabilities to do this kind of work. And we did this beginning in the 1990s, and then we repeated ourselves in the 2000s. Now we're on the third repeat of these processes. And my colleague and boss, Chris Sabine, for all you young students, you got to be really careful how you treat your young students, because my young student, Chris Sabine, is now my boss. So it happened. So I was nice to him, and I'm hoping he's going to be nice to me. That happens. He determined that from the global data sets where all this man-made carbon dioxide exists. And it turns out that more than 50% of that man-made carbon dioxide still exists in the upper 500 meters of the water column. That's because the circulation is very, very slow. The CO2 has to go all the way down to the bottom, circulate through all the oceans, and then come from the bottom into the middle part of the ocean. So actually the oldest water in the Pacific is in the middle part of the oceans and mix like that. It takes tens of thousand years for that circulation process to go through one circuit. That's why most of this CO2 is still up in the upper part of the water column. And my job, as I said, we published this as back-to-back papers in Science to show where this corrosive water was throughout the world oceans, and we mapped that out. And you can see in the Atlantic, it's still quite deep. It's out of the way, not a problem, except for this eastern Atlantic here. In the Indian Ocean, it's quite shallow in the eastern Indian Ocean. But in the Pacific Ocean, the oldest water, there's a lot of respiration occurring, brings that CO2-rich waters back to the surface. So we have very corrosive waters along our coastline from Alaska to southern tip of South America. And so we have these conditions here naturally because of natural respiration process and the addition of man-made CO2 that causes a very severe conditions on our coastline. So this is a time series. I want to show you this time series of model prediction of what the saturation state of seawater will look like. And keep your eye on the purples and blues. Blues are good, reds are bad. And watch what happens over time. So we start at 1880. And we come up to the present. We always see changes taking place that are interesting changes that we can be measuring those changes. By the time we get out to about 2090, we see the entire ocean changing with the reds, meaning it's corrosive, top to bottom. There's no place where calcium carbonate can be produced in the Arctic Ocean, parts of the North Atlantic, parts of the North Pacific, all the Southern Ocean. And in the regions of the tropical oceans, we have such lower saturation state and the coral reefs have a very, very difficult time producing their skeletons. So this is a global problem. And this is a global significance. Again, this is for an IPC scenario, business as usual scenario. So this is a worst case scenario. So this is what it looks like in pH space. This is the pre-industrial 1850 pH conditions here, 8.3 pre-industrial. And by 2100, we would be down here around 7.7, 7.6, something like that. And you can see that in the high northern latitudes and southern latitudes, significant problems. But there are significant problems elsewhere. And interestingly enough, there are vulnerable regions because of natural upwelling processes which bring that CO2-rich water from deep back into shallow regions. And these are the upwelling zones. Upwelling zones are always along the western boundaries of continent. We can see it here off of Africa and here. And so we have a uniquely vulnerable region along our coastline. So for a momentary summary of the chemistry of what we know, approximately 28% of the CO2 that's been generated since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution is absorbed by the oceans. This has caused an increase of 30% of the acidity of the oceans. And the acidity is projected to increase anywhere from 100 to 150% by the year 2100. And the rate of acidification is at least 10 times faster than anything we've seen over the last 50 million years. Now, I'm going to focus a little bit of attention along our coastline, because this is where we consider a lot. We have a unique situation that generally in the wintertime, the winds are from the south, and we have a downwelling conditions. But when the North Pacific high sets up, The winds come from the northwest. That pushes the surface waters offshore and sucks the bottom water along the bottom all the way to the beach and then pushes it out. So this is drawing CO2-rich bottom water along the bottom all the way to the surface and out at the surface. So we would expect an intensification of the acidification process caused by a natural upwelling and the accumulation of anthropogenic CO2 that's coming down from the top. Additive process. So this is a beautiful model output of temperature on the left and pH. This covers the region from Oregon to Southern California. The blue colors for pH here represent the upwelling colors. It starts on January 1st, and you can follow the timing of this process. What I want to point your eyes to is these blue colors as you move through the years. That's the upwelling process, bringing the low pH waters to the surface. The day is the day of the year. We're at the first couple of months. It's all red. All of a sudden, by mid-spring, we start seeing blue. Bam! Occurs right away. Occurs through most of the summer, all the way along, again at the beach, and then spreads out from there and continues on till November or so, when the winds shift back and we have downwelling conditions. So we're seeing this all the way along our coastline. Now we're going to shift gears and talk a little bit about biological impacts and how this acidification affects the marine ecosystems. We have a variety of different methods that scientists have utilized. They're very, very clever at techniques. And developing the first suite of experiments were done, very simple experiments. They were tanks. They increased the CO2 level in the tank, monitored the pH or the CO2, and put a single organism, saw what happened. Then we got more clever. We put mesocosms on coral reef systems by putting a cap over that, adding the CO2, and measuring the changes. These mesocosms allowed light to get through. So more sophisticated, actually looking at how coral reefs. Chris Langdon from the University of Miami did his original work by going to Biosphere 2, controlling the CO2 in the atmosphere at Biosphere 2, controlled environment, and watching the impacts on coral species. So variety of different techniques. A third technique, this is a really interesting technique. Ulf Ribasol from Germany put out these really beautiful mesocosm tanks. They're about 3 meters wide and 10 meters long. And each one then is an entire ecosystem in itself. He increases the CO2 throughout the entire tank to these levels, does everything in triplicate, and studies the biological system over the course of several months. And what he has found and what the colleagues have found is that different species of the lowest trophic levels, the phytoplankton themselves, have different impacts. So, for example, the cyanobacteria, they're very small cyanobacteria, strongly stimulated at high CO2 levels. And again, even nanophytoplankton, again, strongly stimulated. But there are other species like diatoms that don't seem to do, they don't do bad, they just don't do well. So there's going to be a change in the distribution of small phytoplankton versus large phytoplankton. Where that becomes important is that it's a large phytoplankton that takes that carbon away and puts it in a deep ocean. So if you have predominance of small phytoplankton, then that carbon doesn't get into the deep ocean, and the ocean's ability to take up that carbon gets reduced. So a long-term impact of these changes that could take place at the lower trophic levels, quite important to the carbon cycle. It's also important to marine organisms because some marine organisms, they particularly like to eat the diatoms. Others like to eat the nanophytoplankton. So those secondary effects of food resources available and their impacts has to be considered as well. So when we think about this, there are several different types of processes we might expect to see. So as the CO2 levels go up, bicarbonate goes up, CO2, aqueous CO2 goes up, carbonate goes down, pH goes down. There'll be an increase in overall photosynthesis, not a large increase, just a small increase. A decrease in calcifications, the coral species and other calcine species are going to have a more difficult time. There'll be changes in physiology, and there'll be behavioral changes. Now, you superimpose that on other climate-related changes that are taking place, like such as temperature increases due to climate change and oxygen decreases that take place in the oceans, and you have these multiple stressors. Hypoxia and acidification are highly related to each other, and so you have these multiple stressors. So we as scientists have to be able to figure out which one of these processes are the dominant process. So the challenge is to figure out what they are. In some places, we have pollution and oil spills and other things to consider as well. And when we think about it, we can start looking at some of the results, and a lot of good meta-analysis show the results. And it turns out that coral reefs are particularly sensitive to acidification. Coral species, through various components of the life stages, they're very, very sensitive. And even some of the cold water corals have shown some sensitivity as well. But that's still being discussed. One of the most interesting experiments with corals that was done by Katerina Fabricius in New Caledonia region basically went to a region where we have what we call champagne vents, where pure CO2 is being emanated from the seafloor by hydrothermal processes. And this is pure CO2 bubbles being released. And that's like 99% CO2. And if you study a transect from the normal coral reef in towards the venting region, we had 45 species of corals here, very healthy environment. We go into the venting region, and we're left with one or two species. So very, very dramatic changes. pH changes that we saw here were what we might expect to see at the end of the century, 7.8 or so. So it gives us a glimpse in what the future may hold for us. Now, remember the calcifying organisms and other organisms, they are not only food for human people. We like that, so it's important to us. It's important to food security. It's important for our planet because about 1 in 7 people depend on seafood for their main protein in their diet. But it's also fish food. These same species provide fish, so it's an ecosystem importance. And this is really critical to understanding how the ecosystem works. And the coral reefs and other structures form critical habitats for the other organisms. So if we destroy those habitats, what happens to the animals that live there? And a perfect example of a very significant impact that has taken place along our coast is the so-called oyster emergency that started in 2006. So in 2006, the 5 or 6 oyster hatcheries along our coast began to find that it was very, very difficult for them to produce the oyster seed. Now, what happens in oyster in a hatchery is they spawn the oysters in the hatchery, they put them into a large tank, they allow them to grow to a certain size, and then they take them out. They sell the seed to the oyster farmers who spread their seed and develop their oyster farms. And these 5 or 6 hatcheries were having this major problem because they could no longer produce their oyster seed. And in 2007, their production of oyster seed dropped by 80%. Major issue that took place. And they didn't know why. They thought it was a bacterium that was causing this problem. And it turns out that there was a meeting that they had in 2008. We had just completed a cruise, and they invited me to their meeting. And I suggested, your problem is not the bacterium, it's ocean acidification, which means it's really out of their hands. We need help for that. So I will let them tell the story in their own words. I can't see. Can we move the curtain back a little more, please?
From ABC News, this is Good Morning America, live from Times Square.
Welcome back, America, to our 40th annual Earth Day celebration. Oh, by the way, we wanted to talk a little bit about the health of the ocean here. Did you know that the 70% of the Earth's surface is covered by the oceans, and those oceans absorb about 20 million metric tons of greenhouse gases that we put into the air just about every day. Now, we never really thought there was a problem before, but now we're beginning to think it might be.
Mark Waggard and Sue Cudd have each dedicated 30 years of their lives to bringing oysters to our tables. Now the couple's found themselves thrust into the forefront of one of the newest, most pressing environmental issues of our time. And it all began with these tiny, delicate oyster larvae.
In 2007, all of a sudden, our larvae started dying.
The husband and wife team run the Whiskey Creek Oyster Hatchery in Oregon, the largest independent producer of commercial oyster larvae in the country. They produce $10 billion a year for shellfish farmers around the world to grow into the oysters that we recognize. That is, until their production plummeted to zero without any warning.
At first, we thought, what are we doing wrong? After 30 years of being able to produce larvae, all of a sudden we can't.
Desperately, they turned to expert oceanographers. They discovered the Pacific water piped into the hatchery from Neatarts Bay outside the door was to blame. And it wasn't just them.
This is where the Pacific Ocean meets Neatarts Bay. Every day, those waves refresh this bay. That water is roughly filtered, heated a little bit, and pumped directly into these 8,000-gallon tanks. Inside the tank are roughly 40 million swimming oyster larvae. If they're not swimming, that's a problem.
Scientists discovered something was making the water too acidic, preventing oyster larvae from growing shells, and without the shells, it's certain death.
So there you have it. That was the problem. So what we did is we contacted Bria Cantwell, our senator from the state of Washington. We asked for her help. She was able to get $500,000 of stimulus package money to the hatcheries themselves. They used that money to take and purchase and install our CO2 sensors that the oceanographers had right in the tanks themselves, measuring pH and pCO2. We were able to show very conclusively that the problem was the acidity of the water. When the waters came in the early morning, they were highly enriched in their acidity, and they were causing the death of the oysters within about 2 days. And when the pH of the waters was much normal, they did just fine. We showed them how to treat the water, to add sodium carbonate to the water, to increase the pH of the water. They now treat the water. That's a common practice they have now. And now their productivity of the oyster larvae is back up at 100%. And so what they told us is for that $500,000 investment, we saved that industry $35 million in 1 year's time. So here's how science can help industry and how governments can play a role to save that particular industry. A perfect example of how we can adapt to ocean acidification, and provides an example of hope for us all. Here's those oyster larvae. On the left-hand side is a normal oyster larvae. On the right-hand side is the malformed oyster larvae. They can no longer settle to the bottom and form an adult. They're just too malformed. The reason why they have such a difficult problem is because they have no mouthparts when they're born. So they live off the egg yolk sac for the energy to produce that calcium carbonate shell. They got to sink to the bottom, stick to the bottom, and start developing their mouth parts. So if they can't use up all that energy because the pH is too low, they can't do it, they simply die. This is another species. This is called a Limacea halicina. It's a pteropod, a marine pteropod, it's a marine snail. Then it lives in the water column. It swims to the surface at night. It feeds on phytoplankton. It throws out a net like a farmer and brings in, a fisherman brings in that net, eats the phytoplankton. It builds a beautiful, beautiful translucent shell, which you see on the left. On the right-hand side is what the shell looks like after 30 days in 1,100 microatmosphere pCO2 water. You can see the CO2 has eaten away through the shell. I want to show you what they look like swimming. They swim mostly vertical. You can see they swim to the top at night to feed. Then in the daytime, they sink back down the bottom to avoid being eaten. These are the primary food source for pink salmon during the first year of the pink salmon life. So they're part of the whole life cycle for our ecosystems. And they are beautiful animals. There's about 32 different species, and they play a very important role in the life cycle of many of the fisheries we like to eat. This is a shell of a living pteropod that we collected from our coast. The striations on the right-hand side are some evidence of dissolution that has taken place. This is an example of what conditions are right now along our coast in highly acidified waters. You can see clearly the dissolution is taking place. There's no longer translucent. And this is what the shells of those pteropods would look like by about 2050. And the conditions that we see now, that in the pre-industrial, perhaps 18% of the pteropods would have some form of dissolution. Right now in our coastal regions, it's 53%. By 2050, it could be as high as 70%. Very, very dramatic changes occurring over time. This is what it looks like in the nearshore regions along our coast. This is what it looks like in the offshore regions. So as we get closer and closer, we get to those vulnerable regions, you see these impacts occurring along our coast. The pteropods eat the phytoplankton, and they become an important part of the food chain. The fish rather eat the pteropods and the copepods than eat the phytoplankton themselves. So they're a direct route in the food chain. So what happens to the pteropods would have an impact on our salmon and other species. So what we have learned from the biologists is that pteropods are a very important part of the food chain, and they can be as much as 50% of the pink salmon diet, and a 10% decrease in pteropod production could lead to a 20% drop in mature salmon body weight. So you can see these connections from the lower trophic levels, from the phytoplankton to zooplankton to fish. And why this is important is that in the U.S. alone, the seafood industry is about a $37 billion a year industry, and about half of that seafood industry are animals that produce a calcium carbonate shell or skeleton. The other half is fin fish, our salmon, other fish, but they depend on the shellfish for their food for at least half of them. So this is a big issue from as an economic perspective that is a really critically important to our country. And here's all the different species of calcifiers that are being impacted. A very nice global synthesis of the data that just recently was published in 2013 by Whitman and Parton looked at the impacts, the overall impacts in different groups, from corals to echinoderms to mollusks. And as you see, if you increase the CO2 levels, we can start seeing how much of an impact that would take place. Some species are much more sensitive to others. Corals are particularly sensitive. So are mollusks particularly sensitive, but also fish are sensitive as well. So we're getting an overall picture of what the overall impacts might be. And we look at this from a global seafood industry. We can see what the overall impacts from a global perspective are. So for each of these groups, we can see what the global contribution to our economy would be. And you can see it's a very, very large number of billions and billions of dollars. And the latest projections by the economists is by 2100, we could see a decrease in our economy just due to ocean acidification alone of about $1 trillion per year. So this is now a food security issue. If we don't have that food that we depend on for 1 in 7 persons on this planet, where do we go for that food? A very important question to ask. A recent analysis has shown what the impacts along our coast would be as a function of the years that they would actually begin to occur. And as you go into the far northern regions where acidification highly acute because CO2 goes into colder water more readily than warmer water, you can see these impacts are very, very soon, very rapid. As we go into the more warmer tropical regions, we can see the impacts will occur, but a little bit later. So we get a sense of timing of that. This is an indication of the local economies that would be impacted because of their dependence on the fishing industry. And you can see there's a lot of regions where the impacts of the economy would be quite significant. Now, I've talked about a number of different processes. I've only touched the surface of how ocean acidification would impact marine ecosystems. There's reduced calcification, there's shifts in nutrient and trace minerals. pH is a master variable. It affects the chemical composition of seawater. Many, many elements and compounds. For trace metals, it makes some more toxic, some less toxic. So we have to understand how changing pH would affect that. There could be enhanced or reduced tolerance to environmental fluctuations of increased temperature. There'd be changes in species from in a biogeographic regime. Some species would leave an area, others would take their place. Changes to food webs, reduced homing abilities. It shows that high CO2, that some fish can no longer get back to their homes. And interesting studies have shown that the settlement, the stickiness of clams and oysters to the bottom is dependent on the pH because the proteins that hold them to the bottom are weakened by lower pH. And so there are many, many and behavioral changes. One of the most interesting latest study is with clownfish that showed that in high CO2 regions, the clownfish neuroreceptors are affected such instead of swimming away from predators, they swim towards predators. So we have to understand more about behavioral responses as well. So in conclusion, I wanted to point out that our research is at the very beginning stages. We have done lots of studies with abrupt perturbations of pH over usually with single species, over short periods of time, and often with extreme conditions. What we still need to look at, what the research is directing us towards, is looking at the effects of genetic diverse populations. Can some animals, some groups of animals, evolve or adapt to acidification? We think they can, but we have to understand how. Synergistic effects with other stressors, combination of effects. You know, for example, some species of toxic algal blooms actually are affected not only by CO2 levels, but also by temperature. So it's the synergistic effects that become important. Physiological and microevolutionary adaptations. Some animals may be able to adapt, others cannot. We need to understand that. Community and ecosystem response. We need good ecosystem models that say what are the direct effects and what are the indirect effects. And these changes that we see to the chemical environment in the oceans are enough to affect the CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere. Not by a large amount, but by a significant amount. So it has an impact, potential feedback impact, on climate change itself. So what are we doing about it? Well, I'm on an interagency working group. 8 federal agencies are working together, and they have a working group that designs the national program for ocean acidification, and these are the major themes that they work on. I'm proud to be that group, working group. It works very hard. We meet once a month. And we develop all the programs and make sure the programs are interactive and working well together. And more recently, the states have put some skin in the game. Washington, Oregon, and California have now developed a cooperative called the Pacific Coast Cooperative, along with British Columbia. And they're working now with the federal agencies to have a collaborative effort. State of Washington has a state program, ocean acidification. California and Oregon are trying to do much the same. So we're making progress. So in conclusion, the oceans are acidifying rapidly. Some species will be very sensitive to OA. Other species will be able to adapt, and we need to figure out which. Biological responses are going to be a variable, so it's a lot of work for the biologists to carry out. The impacts of OA can transfer through food webs. Other stresses can exacerbate the responses of OA. Increasing temperature, for example, can exacerbate the OA response to coral reefs. And the economic consequences of OA on a global level and even on a local level are quite large. So in summary, this take-home message is it's fairly clear. Mankind's imprint now on the oceans is quite large. The oceans are getting warmer. We have the hottest oceans we have ever measured in our Pacific waters now. They are becoming more acidic, and they're becoming less diverse. Thank you.
Well, you were warned, and I must say, very, very thorough. I have to admit that half of my questions he covered very, very well, so I don't need to ask some of them, and I'll be getting some of your questions up here soon. We'll go till 9 and then cut off then, and then if you have a, if you want to come up and ask Dr. Feely additional questions, feel free for at least a few minutes. So. Starting out, and you actually alluded to this in your opening remarks, you've been at this a long time, 30 years. And can you describe for the audience that first moment when you realized the scope and scale of the ocean acidification problem? When was it, and what evidence tipped the scales for you?
That's an excellent question. I haven't been asked that before. Actually, my very first paper was on ocean acidification that I wrote on the carbon system back in 1982. And it's a good story behind that is that, so I wrote this paper and it was summarily thought as unimportant, completely unimportant, and it was ignored. In fact, a very leading scientist said it's probably wrong at a national meeting. And, you know, when you're a young scientist, and I was just out of graduate school, you can go two ways. You can go hide in a corner and bury your head, or you can do something about it. And I chose to do the latter, and I chose to realize that I didn't have enough data, so I had to go out and get more data. And that was the right response, and we amassed the WOS Hydrographic Survey, and we're able to amass enough data so we could publish this data in Science and show this is indeed a global problem. So the take-home message for me has always been, when you think you are right, keep pursuing it until you're either shown you're wrong or you can prove that you are right.
So even in those early years, when you found the first evidence of ocean acidification, did you ever, in your worst nightmare, think it was really, with all the modeling that's happened subsequent to that, and that it would be such a large scope and scale and happen so quickly?
No, we didn't know that at all. So back in 1980s, we thought this was an interesting geochemical problem and worthy of study. We had no idea the biological implications of that. The biological implications of that came out in the 1990s. And Joni Kleypas, a good friend of mine, published a paper in Science about the impacts on a global scale on coral reefs. The day that came out, I called her up and I said, this is one of the most significant papers I've ever seen. And she said, thank you very much. I didn't think any believed me. So we were at a stage that we were not interacting very well. We're all individuals and we needed to see the connections. And once we saw the connection between the chemistry and biology, that's when things really took off, 1990s and early 2000s.
So in light of these problems and actually seeing, the financial impacts to the oyster industry in the Pacific Northwest, firsthand, what do you think it would take? Let me try to put this in a way that's not so awkward for a federal employee. What It doesn't seem like the urgency from a federal response or an international response is commensurate with the scope of the problem. Is it a believability issue in Washington, D.C. and elsewhere? Should we all hold our breath that something of meaning is going to happen in Paris at the end of the year to try to deal with this? Why has this sort of been almost the afterthought issue when it comes to the impacts of greenhouse gas emissions and CO2 in the atmosphere?
I guess the primary reason, I believe, is because not enough people are concerned about the oceans. Not enough people really think they're worth preserving and taking care of and understand the importance of the oceans to our way of life. As I mentioned, seafood from our planet feeds 1 in 7 persons for protein. We haven't gotten that message across of how important the oceans are to us. You know, they provide us with resources that we're basically taking for granted. And until we get that message about how important the oceans are to our survival, we're not really taken seriously.
Yeah. I actually respectfully disagree on that particular area. It does seem to me that people care about the oceans, but it almost feels like they're overwhelmed on this particular issue. You know, we can start talking about what people can do to make a difference, and it's basically change our lifestyles. Whereas if you look at a plastic pollution problem or sewage in the oceans, it's a small enough local scale that we can make a difference. It seems almost so daunting from the standpoint of the solution because of the scope of the problem and because it's really all related to climate change. Do you think that's a big part of it?
Well, basically all the studies that have been done on awareness of ocean acidification show us how far we have yet to go.
Right.
Only about, at the very most, 10 to 20% of the population knows what ocean acidification is. If we're going to have an impact, we have to have a large majority of the population thinking this is an important issue to deal with. So from an education point of view, we have a long way to go. From understanding of the significance of this to our economy and to our way of life, we have a long way to go. There are solutions. Don't get me wrong. I think we have a major solution that we need to take seriously. That is reducing CO2 emissions. I think that's really important. It's the most important thing we can do. Yeah. Because we need to have time to develop any adaptation strategies that we don't really know how they're going to work yet. So we have to have a slowdown of CO2 emissions to give us enough time to solve this problem. And we do have some adaptation strategies that we're testing right now. But they're only at the very beginning stages. They work well in hatcheries, but you can't use the same approaches in the open ocean. You got to come up with different approaches. And there are some exciting new ideas that are being thrown out. You know, how can you use the ecosystem to help you with this process? For example, putting oysters near eelgrasses. Eelgrasses take carbon out of the water and put it in the sediments. So maybe oysters will go better near eelgrasses. We have lots of eelgrasses around the Pacific Northwest and along our coast. We could be thinking of those adaptation strategies and how they might work better.
So one of the audience questions was the geoengineering question, which is there anything that could be done from the standpoint of, you know, addition of, you know, calcium carbonate, baking soda sorts of things to deal with the problem? So that actually was one of the questions. Does that make sense at any scale?
Not at the global scale at all. I was asked by Al Franken one time on his radio program before he became senator, of how much baking soda would I have to dump in the ocean to solve this problem? And he said, I'm a solutions guy. Tell me how to solve this problem. I said, well, Al, you'll have to take a billion Volkswagen Beetle-sized sodium carbonate every single year going dumped into the oceans. It's just too massive. We can't do that. A billion Volkswagen Beetles worth of sodium carbonate going in the oceans. Just can't do it. So can you do that on a local scale? Maybe. There are some tests that have been done, and the tests are all in the laboratories. We just really haven't gone to the next size experiment, so we don't really know.
So speaking of
sort of the local side, and is there something we can do? As you know, UCLA's own Jim McWilliams, working with the University of Washington's Curtis Deutsch and others, including yourself, recently received funds to do research to model the West Coast of the United States, to really determine what the impacts are of upwelling and climate change in comparison to anthropogenic sources coming from runoff sources, sewage treatment plants, from the standpoint of the sorts of impacts we see on both hypoxia and ocean acidification. Do you expect, with that sort of research effort, do you expect that there's going to be much we can do locally? I mean, does it make sense to change how we do sewage treatment on the coast? Do you think that'll be, or do you think that'll just pale in comparison to the global processes?
Well, when we look at the very local regimes, near coastal regimes, the local impacts can be significant. There's a very wonderful paper by Scott Doney. He published at PNAS in 2007. He said that the local sources of acidification from local natural inputs that we have of nutrients and runoff can increase the acidification locally by as much as 50%, over and above what we get from CO2 in the atmosphere. So in those local regimes, it would have a significant effect, and we're expecting that will be a significant impact. In our major estuaries, we see data sets that suggest that there may be local impacts, such as in Puget Sound, and Hood Canal, and San Francisco Bay. Along the coast in Southern California, we have so much sewage being emitted that those local changes could have a significant impact. You can know that already, that it is, because those local changes are affecting the oxygen distribution, causing hypoxia. When you have hypoxia occurring, that hypoxia is because the oxygen has been taken up by decay of organic matter, and that releases CO2. So hypoxia and acidification are hand-in-glove operations. So hypoxic regions are going to have the lowest pH waters ever measured.
So that answered one of the other questions on why do you always hear OA and hypoxia so closely linked together. Why do we see the phenomenon of not much of an impact on ocean acidification in Southern California, but we do have a pretty significant hypoxia issue. Yet in the Pacific Northwest, obviously we see a much stronger ocean acidification signal.
Okay, so in Southern California, you have the local impacts of sewage discharge having local impacts in nearshore regions on oxygen distributions and therefore acidification impacts as well. But the larger scale phenomenon is the combination of anthropogenic CO2 coming from above and the upwelling. And the upwelling is what drives the transport of low oxygen waters into the coastal regions along our coast. And then the enhanced productivity of raining down organic matter, which is then consumed, producing more CO2 on the shelf than off the shelf, which causes the hypoxic conditions. If those waters are retained for a month or two or three, you get it into hypoxic regimes. Those will always be your lowest pH waters, 7.7, 7.6, even 7.5. Very corrosive waters.
So a related question, one of the audience members asked, so what's the dynamic that's driving the coastal trends in the tropical regions?
In the tropical regions, that is primarily driven by the atmospheric CO2 itself. And that changes are different than we see in the higher latitudes because the waters are warmer, saturation state is naturally higher. So you see a decrease of in the pre-industrial saturation state was probably around 3.5 to 4. Now we're seeing it closer to 3, so we're dropping that saturation state by the addition. But because it's warmer waters, those saturation states are high, those animals have a better chance. One of the hatcheries that was on the Washington coast moved to Hawaii for that very reason. Warmer waters, they could be more successful there. So we lost 20% of our production by moving there.
Hey, you talked a lot about the species impacts and the ecosystem effects, and obviously very dramatic from the standpoint of the impacts to oysters and the impacts to pteropods, and you know, speculative impacts, or are they real impacts? Have they actually been seen on coral reef systems? And if so, can you describe them at this point?
In the natural environment, the two that you mentioned, the third thing we've seen in the natural environment are forams, significant impacts on forams. We have not seen direct effects on coral reefs right now. All that has been done by laboratory studies. So we take much of the projections based on the laboratory studies as to what conditions will be in the future, but we also go into the field and see if we see any impacts right now, and we have not seen that yet. So we're at the very early stage. Again, we have an opportunity to make a difference.
Great. Another person asked, West Coast sensitivity, are they more sensitive to ocean acidification because of upwelling, or where does temperature come into play on this, and do we see significant ocean acidification, for example, on the East Coast?
We see significant, I'll answer the second part first. We see significant ocean acidification on the East Coast near river mouths. So when rivers discharge into the ocean, they're bringing in water that is very low in pH, usually around close to 7 or so. And they have very low alkalinity. So when they get discharged into the coastal region, there is that impact of the anthropogenic CO2, which has been lowering the pH, and that having an impact on our coastal regions in the East Coast regions. Interestingly enough, you know, acid rain impacts over time has had an impact on our agricultural processes. So some rivers have it increasing pH rather than a decreasing pH because of the agricultural process and the effect of acid rains on those lands, which then release bicarbonate ion into those rivers and actually show increasing. So you got to look at each river. Mississippi River is the most clear example. The alkalinity in the Mississippi River has been increasing, not decreasing, some of the East Coast rivers. On our side, many of those rivers are actually much more acidic. So you have to look at it region by region. So that answers that one. In our region, temperature makes a major significant impact. And so when that upwelled water is coming in, it's bringing in very cold water, about 8 degrees or so. Normal surface waters might be around 10 or 12 degrees, depending on the time of year. So it's bringing in cold water, it's bringing in acidic water, and then you have this contribution of anthropogenic CO2 coming from above, mixing with those waters and coming in. One of the questions that was asked of me a long time ago, okay, that upwelled water, that's all a natural process, we can't do anything about it. It's not true. When that upwelled water reaches the surface, it has mixed with enough water from the surface that 69% of that increased DIC is due to anthropogenic CO2. So we are still the dominant force on this.
All right, well, I can tell you the number one question is in regards to how do we deal with the CO2 problem. So I think there's probably about 10 cards, and probably of those, the most popular is, what do you think about putting a price on carbon?
All right, now I have to put on my government hat. And my government tells me very explicitly that I can talk to you about the science, I can't talk to you about policy. I can't address it. You can imagine what I would say, but I can't say it.
So, okay. Everybody use your imagination, close your eyes. All right, and so in that imagination, what would that price be? All right, fair enough. I'm not surprised in light of the controversy around the issue. All right, another question is, so on the acidification side, and never seen this question before on OA, so interesting. You know, you look at places like the Florida Keys, et cetera, I mean, and we talked a lot about potential impacts on reefs. What about on calcium carbonate geology from the standpoint of where people live? Is there any sort of impact potentially there?
Well, a lot of discussion has been made on the impact of the structures of coral reefs. And there's been some really nice papers that have been written to just show, for example, how strong is a coral reef when it has been impacted by ocean acidification. And, you know, there are a bunch of micro borers that bore into the coral reefs and weaken the coral reef. And unfortunately, they do much better in a high CO2 world. And so the research has suggested that the increased CO2 causes a faster breakdown of coral reefs.
So, but do you, to extrapolate on that, do you see structural instability in limestone reef geology along the shore, or is that taking things too far?
Well, all the work that has been done so far has been on living coral right. species. And so we're basing on at a very few number of sites. So
okay.
I would assume so, but a lot more work has to be done.
Okay, all right. And acidification, anything else causing acidification? One of the people wrote a question in regards to the sorts of acidifying of lakes that we've seen all over this country, and does sulfate have an impact on these sorts of things, or is it trivial in comparison?
As I said, Scott Doney's work has shown that in very nearshore regions, when you have power plants that provide other gases, nitric acid and sulfuric acid, that independent contribution to the acidification in some highly industrialized regions can add about 50% to those coastal regions of the acidification. They're industrialized areas. On the West Coast, we don't see as much of it as they have on the East Coast. That's the best example I have of that.
Okay. A couple of people, tells you we have a pretty educated audience, a couple of people were asking about genetic pre-adaptation to ocean acidification and if there's something that can be done to sort of, you know, isolate those genes and maybe modify organisms. I'm not making this up. I got two of them. And so from the standpoint, or at least identifying those organisms that are more pH tolerant and basically creating situations for those organisms to thrive so we don't have total losses. Is that something that anybody's looking at? Does that have any promise?
Yeah, there's several groups that are looking at it from that perspective. Gretchen Hoffman from University of California, Santa Barbara, and her groups look at that. They look at in high variability environments, some organisms like sea urchins tend to do better than low variability environments. That's one way of looking at that. If you have high degree of variability that expose the high highs and the low lows, can they actually develop adaptations to be resilient to that? And there's some evidence that can occur. And some of the work with oysters in Australia have shown that the parents, when placed in high CO2 environments, produce offspring that are more resilient. So there's little bits and pieces of information that suggest that there's some hope for resilience. The problem is it's going to be different for different species, and we really don't understand how this plays out in enough examples yet to be certain of that. We have a long way to go from a scientific perspective.
Okay. A number of other questions talk about the vulnerability. You talked about the calcareous organisms, many at the bottom in the food chain. And you talked about the vulnerability of potentially a pink salmon and their populations because of the impacts that you've already seen to pteropods. With potential impacts to coccolithophores, other calcareous organisms, what should we expect from the standpoint of, you know, the next large group of organisms or next highest trophic level where we could start in certain parts of the world where we'd start seeing impacts. Do you have any prediction on what we might see in the next 5-10 years?
Well, I suspect one of the things I will say, and I'm saying this to the scientific community out there who can make a difference, we don't have enough experiments in the field to correspond with the experiments in the laboratories. So it's very, very few experiments that we have and where we have the chemistry and the physics and the biology all together in the field. And what when we do have that, it's interesting that they tend to support the laboratory studies. But we have very few studies in the field. And we really need to understand, again, from an evolutionary point of view, is that if there's a high degree of genetic diversity, can they be resilient and how that will work? You only, I guess the best way I understand is that, sure, you got to do all that work in the laboratory, but you have to get it to be verified in the field. And I think there's ways to do that. We're very at the rudimentary stages of doing that. So my suggestion is that if we're setting up this global monitoring network and we're trying to link up the federal government, the state government, and the local groups together, why not have those as sites for experimental biology to be done? In a way, you have all the chemistry done for you. You have all the physics and the modeling. The modeling work's critically important. But unless we have all those biological responses, we don't know how to put them in the models. So we got to start thinking about how we do these experiments enough so we can get at very good estimates of what the response of the organisms and put that into the models. We've got to start working together and get an integrated, interdisciplinary approach to this, not the piecemeal way we've been doing it in the past.
So personally, I want to thank you so much for coming down here tonight and giving the lecture. Also, I want to thank you personally for providing mentorship and a fellowship for my son to work on pteropods with you last summer.
Some of that data that I showed on the screen was Zach's work. So I'm very excited about the work he's doing. I'm glad he's going to continue on.
Oh, I'm excited. I finally have a Bruin in the family. Too many Cardinals. It's good to get a Bruin, finally. No Trojans are allowed in my family. They'd be disowned absolutely.
You haven't sent us too many Huskies either.
But anyways, I know many of you asked specifically what we can all do to make a difference. And just on that closing note, I do want to say, it's really the same answers on every single climate change talk that you've seen in the last 10 plus years. So anything you can do to reduce your greenhouse gas emissions in your everyday life, anything you can do to make everybody take this seriously at the elected level. Obviously, we're very lucky to be in the state of California where it's being taken more seriously here than anywhere else in the rest of the world. We'll see what happens in Paris at the end of November. At least it looks a heck of a lot more promising than Copenhagen. But from the standpoint of ensuring that this really becomes a much higher priority, you see what's at stake with the scope and scale of this ocean acidification problem, and that people in Washington, D.C. have to start taking it a heck of a lot more seriously. So thank you guys for your attendance tonight, and hope you guys learned a lot as much as I did.